I'm going to start off with some chemistry climate model simulations, and I'll tell you a little bit, next slide, what a chemistry climate model is. You'll need to know because Julie's going to talk about the same sort of thing. And I'm going to show you what the world would have looked like, where's the pointer, if ozone-depleting substance emissions had grown by about 3% per year from 1974 onwards. And the simulation is described in detail in a paper, which you can see the details of here. I'm going to show you a little bit about how stratospheric halogen loading would have changed under such a scenario. I'm going to talk about ozone changes globally. I'm going to show you what would have happened here in Canberra had there been no Montreal Protocol. And I'll talk about both ozone and UV radiation under such a scenario. And again, I'm going to pick up on the point that Paul raised and talk a little bit more about the importance of the Montreal Protocol in protecting climate. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about these chemistry climate model simulations. So the first point to note is the world is complicated, and it's complicated also in the stratosphere. And what I've shown in this little schematic here is all the different connections between things like stratospheric ozone, stratospheric temperature, tropospheric temperature, so you're thinking about climate there, greenhouse gases, halogens that Paul just talked about. There's a lot of different interactions here. And if you want to think about what the ozone layer is going to be doing over the coming decades, and if you want to simulate that with a model, your model has to capture all these interconnections and all this complexity. To do that, you develop something called a chemistry climate model. It's a climate model that includes simulation of stratospheric chemistry. And you run that model forward, let's say, for 100 years. And it might take you a few months on a supercomputer to run that simulation. Because you're going in 15-minute time steps, it's very, very complicated. And so what I've done is I've taken such a simulation using the GOS-CCN. This is a chemistry climate model that's run in the US. And I'm going to be showing you some results from that chemistry climate model simulation. Okay, so let me show you a little bit about stratospheric halogen loading. You should already be very familiar with this, having just heard Paul's talk, because here is a little bit what Paul showed you. So observations of this metric called equivalent effect of stratospheric chlorine, and remember from what Paul said, it really is just an aggregation of the chlorine and bromine in the stratosphere effective in depleting ozone. And what you can see with the blue curve is observations, and then the red curve is what we think is going to happen, exactly what Paul showed, going into the future out to about 2070 in this case, under this AB scenario of WMO. And this is what we expect will happen under the Montreal Protocol. This is what would have happened when the Montreal Protocol was first put in place. And then there were various amendments and adjustments that led to this red line. Had there been no protocol and had emissions of ozone-depleting substances continued to grow by 3% per year from 1974, we would be on this black line, reaching about 45.6 parts per billion by 2065. Noting that under the Montreal Protocol, we're looking at a peak of about 4.3 parts per billion. And so you can see there would have been this rapid increase in effective equivalent stratospheric chlorine had there been no protocol. With the protocol, we expect, well, it's peaked, it's on its way down, and we expect to be down to about 2.8 parts per billion by the middle of the century. Okay, so here's a quick global view of what ozone would have done had there been no Montreal Protocol. And what I've done is I've taken ozone at 20 kilometers altitude. This is around 50 hectopascals in the atmosphere. This is the North Pole at the top, South Pole at the bottom. I've put a red dotted line where Canberra is, going from 1974 through to 2075. And ozone is shown, and the lowest ozone levels are shown in blue, the highest in red. And blue in this case means almost zero. And what you can see is here in Canberra, ozone gets less and less and less, and then really takes a rapid dive here. And by 2075, you would have almost no ozone at 20 kilometers altitude over Canberra. And the scientific term we use to describe such an event is very, very bad. What you can see over the equator is something quite interesting. Ozone stays between about 1.4 and 1.6 parts per million, and then suddenly decreases almost to zero. And the reason for that is what happens here with this collapse of tropical ozone just after the middle of the century is the chemistry that was responsible for the Antarctic ozone hole actually now starts to come into play in the tropics. And you get this heterogeneous chemistry that was depleting ozone in the Antarctic now starts depleting ozone in the tropics. It gets cold enough for that to happen. Okay, so here's life in Canberra with the Montreal Protocol. And this is ozone in Dobson units plotted on the vertical axis. The orange dots are observations. These are annual average values, annual average ozone. This is a combination of various satellite-based and ground-based instruments from 1979 through to last year. And then the yellow dots are the projection with this chemistry climate model going through to 2075. And what you can see, exactly as a result of the protocol, where did the little arrow go? There it is. So with the turnaround of this equivalent effect of stratospheric chlorine, we see a recovery of the ozone layer. And in fact, by the end of the 20th century, by 2075, you actually end up with more ozone than you would have had in the 1970s and 1980s. You can ask me why later. Now, probably some of you are thinking, why the hell has he put such a big vertical axis on here? Why is he going all the way down to 100 Dobson units when there's such a small variation here? It's because without the protocol, this is what would have happened to ozone over Canberra. By 2075, you would be down to 100 Dobson units. Keep in mind, anything below 220 is considered Antarctic ozone hole type levels. And so that's what would have happened here. And what I'm going to show you now are just some maps of the southern hemisphere, some snapshots. So if we were to look at ozone in October of the year 2000, anything that's green or blue is Antarctic ozone hole type levels. Here's Australia sitting over here. So in October 2000, there's the Antarctic ozone hole. By 2030, ozone hole hasn't got much bigger. It's certainly got a lot deeper. We're getting values well below 60 Dobson units now inside the Antarctic ozone hole. Over here, over the sort of tropics, we start to see these greenish colors. You know, now you're starting to see ozone hole type values. And then by 2075, the entire southern hemisphere is sitting under ozone hole conditions in October. It's really, going back to that technical term, very, very bad. On the other hand, with the Montreal Protocol, by October 2070, this is what ozone looks like. No ozone hole at all. Nice big ridge of ozone over the southern mid-latitudes, and if anything, more ozone over Canberra than there would have been in October 2000. So that shows very clearly exactly what we think would have happened under such a scenario. What does this mean for the UV index? So what I've done is I've taken the ozone time series out of that model simulation for Canberra, run that through a radiative transfer model, and calculated what the clear sky, this is in the absence of clouds, what the clear sky UV index would have been from, I'm going now from 1974, again through to 2075, a 100-year simulation. Anything that's red or yellow or gray or purple is extreme UV values. That's UV indices above 10. And what you can see is back in the 1970s and even through to around now, you're seldom getting values above 13 or 14 as the UV index. This is summertime noon UV indices. But without the Montreal Protocol, it very quickly increases above 15, 20, 25, 30, up to a UV index of 35. And if you start to think about the time of the day when the UV index exceeds this extreme value of 10, you can see in 1980, it's about 3.5 hours, centered around noon. But without the Montreal Protocol, that would have slowly expanded until at 8:30 in the morning, you're having to put sunscreen on because the UV index is exceeding 10. So you would have seen a very big, about a 4-hour increase in that period during the day where the UV index is rising above 10. Okay. What about Antarctica? So what I've plotted here on the vertical axis is the month of the year, going from January through to December, and again the years across the bottom. This is ozone averaged between 70 degrees south and 90 degrees south. 70 hectopascals up in the atmosphere, in the stratosphere. It's about the level where the Antarctic ozone hole really gets a good grip on ozone. And what you can see is in the months of October and November, this is when the model simulates a nice Antarctic ozone hole. This is the Antarctic ozone hole where ozone is being depleted. But then as we proceed through the century and as this equivalent effect of stratospheric chlorine starts rising, eventually what had been a seasonal phenomenon, what had been ozone depletion over Antarctica only in October and November, now becomes a year-round phenomenon. You have Antarctic ozone hole year-round. Okay, so, but would it have ever really come to this? And this picks up on the point that Paul raised. Many of the ozone depleting substances, these ODSs, are also greenhouse gases. And they're often very potent greenhouse gases. And what I've shown here is a thing called a global warming potential. This tells you that 1 ton, well, 1 ton of CFC-11 emissions would be equivalent to 4,680 tons of CO2 emissions when you consider the impact of those gases on climate warming over a 100-year time horizon, looking into the future 100 years. So these are 100-year global warming potentials. And you can see that these global warming potentials are extremely high. A ton of CFC-114, nearly equivalent to 10,000 tons of emission of CO2. And so the general feeling is that it's unlikely that things would have got as bad as I showed you with regard to ozone. Scientists would have quickly realized, oh, good grief, these ozone-depleting substances are also greenhouse gases, and we're seeing rapid climate warming coming as a result of them. So the ODSs would have added an additional 0.8 to 1.6 watts per square meter of radiator forcing by 2010. So even in the last few years, if ODS emissions had continued to grow, keeping in mind that the CO2 radiator forcing is around 2.6, 2.7 watts per square meter, so it would have become about half of what we're seeing from CO2. And then continue to grow thereafter. And so I'm going to show you some figures now. I'll talk you through them. These, on the top panel here, these are emissions of various gases. So you can see here the CFCs, and this is very much along the lines of exactly what Paul showed. So these are the emissions peaking just around 1987, and then as a result of the Montreal Protocol, they fade away. HCFCs, which some of the replacement chemicals for the CFCs, also continue to fade away. But then there has been an accelerated phase out, an agreement to phase out the CFCs faster than what had originally been agreed on. And this was one of the strengths of the Montreal Protocol, that you could have some preliminary steps, and then as new scientific evidence becomes available, actually start to strengthen the protocol on various aspects. And so this faster phase out of the HCFCs makes it look like this. And then you've got the HFCs, remembering that the HFCs are controlled under the Kyoto Protocol, coming in here. Now, when you start to think about what these emissions means in terms of ozone depletion, you can weight these emissions by their ozone depleting potential. That's what this ODP stands for. It's the ozone depletion potential. And it tells you how important this gas is compared to CFC-11. And so straight away, when you move to an ODP-weighted emissions kind of plot, well, the HCFCs, their importance goes away because they're nowhere near as potent as CFC-11 in depleting ozone, and the same is certainly true for the HFCs. They do not deplete ozone at all because they don't have any chlorine or bromine in them. And so you can see, again, there's the effects of the Montreal Protocol kicking in, and that's what would have happened, would have just kept going up there if it had not been for the Montreal Protocol. Then you can go and think about the global warming potential weighted emissions. So this is now how important these gases are. And it comes to an important point. You've got this ODP number. That tells you how important is this gas for depleting ozone. You've got GWP. How important is this gas for warming climate? One thing scientists should do, and I've been pushing this point for a number of years now, I want to introduce something new called the TBI. This would be the Total Badness Index. And it would tell you, so you don't have to choose between ozone depletion and global warming. What's the total effect of any gas on the environment in general, not thinking about the climate and ozone separately. When you start to look at these GWP weighted emissions and you look at what would have been the case with no protocol, what is the case with the Montreal Protocol, and you look at this big gap here, and you compare that gap to what would have been achieved, or what was aimed to be achieved, under the first commitment period of the Kyoto Protocol, that runs from 2008 to 2012, so we're coming up to the end of it in a few months. It's about five times as big as what was hoped to be achieved under the Kyoto Protocol. So the Montreal Protocol really has had, exactly as Paul said, a huge impact on climate protection. Okay, so here are my conclusions. Without the Montreal Protocol, about 17% of the globally average ozone would be destroyed by 2020, and 67%, two-thirds of all the ozone gone, by 2065 compared to 1980 values. Largest losses would have been in the polar regions, and that large polar ozone depletion that would have just happened previously in October and November would now be year-round. changes in vertical motion in the tropics coming from changes in climate, coming from the warming of climate by these ozone-depleting substances, which are greenhouse gases, that would cause cooling of the lower stratosphere in the tropics, and suddenly you get this chemistry that was only happening in the Antarctic ozone hole, now happening in the tropics, and just runs off a cliff, that ozone in the tropics. And you must keep in mind that's also where UV is already high, so you have massive increases in UV over the tropics. Over Canberra, well, ozone declines steadily, reaches ozone hole type values, 220 Dobson units by 2040, and ozone values as low as 100 Dobson units by 2075. For the UV, that UV index exceeding 10, that threshold of extreme UV values, expands from 3.5 hours to 7.5 hours over the course of the century. And you get peak UV indices of 35. And then one thing I didn't explore and I haven't shown you at all is that when you've got that much UV now coming down into the troposphere, that really has a big effect on tropospheric chemistry. And no one's really had a good look at that. And finally, the same point that has already been raised, the Montreal Protocol has really played a key role in protecting climate. And that's probably why things would not have got this bad, just in terms of ozone and UV. The climate impact would have kicked in and people would have realized what's going on. Good. Thank you very much.